Acts chapter 9, 42 to 48. Are we all there? 42. And whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believed in me, it is better for him that the millstone were hanged about his neck, and he were cast into the sea. 43. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. 45. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life, than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. 47. And if thy foot, and if thy eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into a hell fire, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. These are the words of Jesus. These are the teachings of Jesus when he was teaching the disciples and the multitude about hell. That there is a place called hell, and that this place called hell is a place that the fire never goes out. The fire keeps burning, the fire burns for eternity. And Jesus also said that there are worms inside that place called hell. That the worms, they don't die. The worms remain forever. They don't die. The worms, they are there to punish those believers, those souls that will sin against God. Those souls that will sin against God. And this passage of the Bible, the book of Mark chapter 9, verse 42 to 48, was prophesied by Isaiah. Open your Bible to the book of Isaiah chapter 66. The last episode of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 66. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 24. Are we all there? It says, and they shall go forth and look upon the carcass of the men that have transgressed against me. For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched. And they shall be an abhorrence unto all flesh. This was the prophecy of Isaiah. This was the prophecy God gave to Isaiah. That Isaiah, I want you to tell the people of Israel, I want you to tell these people, that a day is coming, a certain day will come, that they will see dead bodies. They will see their fellow ones, their fellow loved ones in hell. That they will see them in hell crying. Those who have sinned against God, you will hear about them that they are in hell, they are crying. Worms, they are feeding on them. That their worms will not die and the fire will not quench. And yet Jesus Christ came. And he was teaching the people about hell. All the words of Jesus, any words spoken by Jesus, they must surely come to pass. When Jesus said that the worm does not die, you need to know that what Jesus said is everlasting. When he said the fire will not quench, it means the fire will not go out. The fire will continue forever. May the Lord give us an understanding of his word in the name of Jesus. Matthew chapter 8, verse 12. It says, but the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. These are also the teachings of Jesus. This was the teaching of Jesus. That the children of the kingdom, meaning that the children which the kingdom of God was originally made for, who fell into error, Jesus Christ, that they will be cast out into outer darkness, a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth, a place Jesus. When God was saying this, God was indirectly talking to his own children. That you, who are saying you are my children, if you decide to leave me and do wickedness against me, I will judge you with that wickedness. All your works, I will forget everything. He said, but he, the Gentiles, the heathen, if they can turn to me, say then, all the evil they have done against me, I will forget everything and I will judge them with their righteousness. I will judge them with their righteousness. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. This thing that the Lord said happened to my grandmother, my great-grandmother. What God told Ezekiel happened to her. This woman, she served God all the days of her life, and before she died, she made an error. And God forgot about all her works and judged her with that error. Today, she's in hell. She's in hell. Every word spoken by God, God means it, and he must bring it to fulfillment. Remember, Jesus Christ said that every word that he has spoken out of his mouth, every word spoken by God must surely come to pass. No letter will be missed out. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Amen. Yesterday we heard that a great man of God is in hell. This man, he served God. He worked for God, but he decided to leave God and do iniquity, and God forgot about all his good works. And God judged him with his error, and today that man is in hell. Today he is in hell. Jesus Christ said he is not a respecter of persons. He is not a respecter of persons. Now the sessions I will be sharing with us today is the sessions of punishment that concerns most Christians. Christians. The errors that Christians are doing in the church that Jesus is trying to correct. The Lord Jesus took me to a section in hell. And this section that the Lord took me to, the section of punishment for idol worshippers. Idol worshippers. Remember, the Bible says that you cannot serve two masters. But today you see somebody, how can somebody, you say you are a Christian, but the tradition of your fathers, you still obey them. You see, the bucket that a woman used to beat, the men, they don't use it. Tradition of your land, tradition of your fathers. And you are saying you are a Christian. You are not a Christian, you are a pagan. You are an idol worshiper. Jesus Christ said, you cannot serve two masters. You must love one and hate the other. Idol worshippers. And in this place, I saw many, very many people. There were very many, and they were tormented by a very serpent in hell. In hell, there is a very serpent. That serpent is very big. And the serpent has thorns, sharp objects all over its body. And this serpent wrapped their throat in hell. The serpent wrapped every one of them. They were crying, shouting, trying to remove the serpent from their throat, but they cannot. Worms were eating them. Fire was burning them. Demons was also tormenting them. They were crying. And when they saw the Lord, every one of them, they were shouting, begging him for forgiveness, begging him for mercy, telling him that they will not serve idols again, that he should have mercy on them and bring them out from that place. But the Lord was crying. He was crying for them. And in this section of hell, I saw Pope John Paul in this place. Pope John Paul II, I saw him in this place. He was also tormented by this very serpent. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Amen. So the Lord dropped me in this place. And immediately I landed in this place. The demon then rushed at me. The demon pressed me down. He made me to squat like the others. And then the very serpent came out from the rock in hell. And the very serpent wrapped our clothes. We are crying, shouting, begging the Lord for mercy. But Jesus turned his back. He was crying. Blood was coming out of his body. And the demons said they were happy. They were laughing at us. The demons were telling us, when you are asked to worship idols, and the Bible says in the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verse 3 to 5, that you should have no other gods beside who? Your creator. You should not serve them, not worship them, but you disobey. Now we will punish you in this place forever. And the demons will increase the punishment. Demons were using all manner of weapons in hell. They punish us. Every one of us will be lamenting, crying. But Jesus turned his back. He was weeping. Blood was coming out of his body. The Lord cried and cried. There was a time he cried and blood began to come out from his eyes. Blood began to come out from his nose and his mouth. Where people were just filled up with blood. Because as he saved souls in hell, the punishment he went through on the cross, all what he suffered, everything is returning back on him again. How he came to suffer and die for man because of the love he had for man. Everything will be coming back afresh on him. And God is not happy. But this same Jesus we are killing every day is still the one pleading before God for us. I want to tell us something. There was a time in heaven that God got annulled because of the iniquities of man. And God commanded the angels, because they are angels that are holding the trumpets, and they are waiting for God to give the command that they should sound the trumpets. And immediately God gave the command, the trumpets will be sounded, and then rapture will take place, and great destruction will come upon this world. So God got annulled, and he commanded the angels, sound the trumpet that want to destroy man. Man is very wicked. Let me wipe my heart from the face of this earth. And the angels, they placed the trumpet in their mouth. Immediately they made the attempt to sound the trumpet. Jesus appeared there immediately. He was naked. He was not putting on anything. This one we watch in our television, that was not how Jesus suffered. Jesus Christ was naked, nothing. The whole world saw his nakedness, saw his shame. He was naked, he was crying, blood was coming out from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. The crown of thorns was on his head. He was crying and he was showing his father his hand, his side and his feet. He was begging for us. And before the throne of God, there's a golden altar there. And inside that golden altar, there's fire there always burning. That is where the prayers and the praises of the saints enter first before it ascends to God. So all your prayers and all your praises to God, you are rendering it as a sacrifice for him. So out of that altar, the blood of Jesus was overflowing from that altar. He was crying bitterly. And when God saw how his son was begging for man because of the love he had for man, God told him, my son, because of you, I give man another chance. Because of Jesus, God has given us extra time for man to amend his ways. And if man still refuses to amend his ways, when the destruction of God will come, man will be without excuse. There are so many occasions that God gave man a matter of years that they should amend their ways. In the generation of Noah, the Bible says God gave man 120 years to amend his ways. And out of the whole world, for that 120 years, only 8 people amended their ways. The rest multitude, God wiped them out from the face of the earth. When it comes to the days of David, because of the iniquity and the errors of man, God reduced the lifespan of man to 70. And God said, if any man should exceed 70, to be by strength. In supposing they are writing another Bible, God has cut down the lifespan of man that today you see infants, they are dying. Why? Because of iniquity, because of errors that man is committing against God. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Idol worshippers. Many of you here, you are coming to church. You say you are a Christian, but you still follow the tradition of your land. You follow the tradition of your land. Some of you who are met when you go home to see your family, to see your loved ones. You even go to see your uncle. Your uncle will bring kind, will bring drink. And both of you will pour little on the floor. Saying you are giving drink to your ancestor. Your ancestor that is in hell crying. You are giving him drink. But if you continue like that, that ancestor you are serving, you will die and you will go and join him there. And all these things you are doing, many of you, you go into second burial. Your father, your mother that has been dead for many years. You say you want to go and do second burial. Maybe they are there. As you are celebrating their second burial here, their punishment is increasing over there. And if you die like that, you will go and join them. You will go and join them. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. So we continue like that, crying and begging the Lord for mercy. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing. And he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And as I was coming out of this place, the fairy serpents allowed me to go. Then the Lord brought me out of this place and he consoled me. Then I felt peace. Then he gave me scripture, Exodus chapter 20, verse 3 to 5. Open your Bible very quickly to the book of Exodus 20, 3 to 5. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3 to 5. He says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. When you are serving idols and you are serving God, you hate God. And you will discover that the iniquities of your fathers, God will bring it upon you. This is the commandment of God. You can never serve two masters. It is either you love one and you hate the other. Serve one and you hate the other. Jehovah said, choose you this day whom you will serve. If you want to serve me with the whole of your heart. Because of the errors of man, because man don't want to serve God. God now gave man a permissive way. He told man, I said before you this day, life and death, good and evil. But because of the love God had for man, he said, man, I advise you to choose life that you believe. But today, men, they refuse to choose that life that God has given to them. They refuse to choose that life that God has set before them. And today, man is perishing by the day. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord took me from that place, and the Lord took me to another place. The section of punishment for those who hate each other. Hatred. Hatred. Today, hatred is found in the house of God. You see, brothers and sisters who call themselves Christians in the house of God, they hate themselves. Any little thing, quarreling and fighting inside the church. Hatred. Hatred. You don't forgive. You hate yourselves. You come to the church, you are sitting at the front, and they brought that person that you hate with all your heart. you hate that person with passion. Now the person you come and sit down close to you, you carry your Bible, you go and look for another six. All these things have disorganized the church of Christ, and Jesus is crying bitterly every day for the church. Many of these little quarrels, mine is as strong. Some of you, your pastor will try to settle you. It is that time that the fire of the malice will increase. And many of you will say, I have forgiven him, but he's still in my little finger. You have not forgiven. You have not settled. Jesus advised the disciples. He told the disciples before he ascended to heaven, he said, walk in love. Walk in love. Walk in unity. Walk as one. But today, in this last day, the church of God, we don't have love, we don't love one another, we don't work together. One thing that Muslim is good about, they have love, they work together. The unity that Muslims have, if Christians can have that unity, everything will work out in their unity. If you see a Muslim man, maybe that Muslim man, he has something to do. He will go and call all his fellow Muslims. They will sit down, they will talk, and every one of them will come to one agreement. But today in the church, nothing like that. No unity, no love. And that is why Muslims, anything they lay their hand to do, they always succeed. Why? Because of unity. The Muslims, the unbelievers, they understand the power of unity more than the Christians. That is the truth. They understand the power of unity more than the Christians. Because they were taught in their Quran that you should love your brothers, fight and die for your brother. But today in the Christian race, nothing like that. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Instead of love, hatred is found in the house of God. And in this place, demons were tormenting them with canes or tongues. Cane that happens. This was what demons were using to punish them. Demons were tormenting them. Demons were telling them, you say you are a Christian and you hate yourself, you hate each other. Now we will punish you in this place forever. And when they saw the Lord, every one of them, they were crying, they were begging him for mercy, but Jesus did not pay attention to them. The demons, they were happy, they were jubilating, they were smiling, looking at each other. And so I was also punished with them. Demons were tormenting us with canes of thorns. They were flogging us, and they were laughing. They were telling us, when you are an ant, you have the spirit of hatred, you hate yourselves. Now you are dead, we will punish you in this place, we will punish you in this place forever. And the demons, they will increase the punishment. We were all crying and begging the Lord for mercy, but the Lord turned his back. Jesus was crying. Blood was coming out of his body. Hatred is in the house of God. The spirit of hatred is in the house of God. So we continued crying and begging for mercy. We begged the demons for mercy. The demons told us to keep quiet. That in that place called hell, there is nothing like mercy. There's no mercy in that place called hell. In hell, when the demons, when they are tormenting you, when they punish you, it will tell the demons, have mercy. Have mercy. They will translate it in their own language that they understand. In their ears, have mercy sounds as torment me the more in their ears. If you tell them, have mercy, instead of the punishment to decrease, it will increase it more. And no amount of pleading, no amount of begging, we will beg them that will make them have mercy on you. Why? Because that was the instruction given to them by their master, the devil. The devil told them, show no mercy to anyone. He said, why? Because God did not show mercy to him. Man was not there when Satan committed the sin against God, but today man is the one suffering for the sin of Satan. You see the craftiness of Satan. why he used his craftiness to make man suffer for the sin he committed. He was the one who planned to dethrone God, and he did not succeed. God drove him out. And God brought man and placed man in the position of Satan, and Satan got annoyed. And then Satan began to make war against man, and he conquered man. And he brought man under his subjection, under his powers for many years, for many generations. Man was still laboring under the bondage of Satan. Until Jesus Christ had to come and deliver man from the bondage of Satan. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. We are begging the demons for mercy. The demons did not have mercy. They told us to keep quiet. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And he turned and he looked at me and he was smiling. He was laughing and he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me. Then I felt peace. Then he gave me scripture, Psalms 34, verse 21. The book of Psalms 34, verse 21. Book of Leviticus chapter 19 verse 17. Leviticus chapter 19 verse 17. The Lord took me to a place in hell, the section of punishment for those who refuse to repent. Many Christians, they know that they don't have the genuine salvation. They know that they have not experienced genuine salvation. They have the opportunity. But they postpone it. They are procrastinating. Tomorrow I will give my life to Jesus. I will genuinely give my life to Jesus. Tomorrow has come, they postpone it. By next week, I will give my life to Jesus. Next week has come, they postpone it. Next month. And so they continue like that until they die and they go to hell. And in this place, demons were tormenting them with gates of thorns on their backs. And the demons were telling them, you are a fool. You are a fool. You have so many opportunities. You have several opportunities to repent. But you are procrastinating. Saying it is next month, it is next week, it is next year you will repent. All these things, they are done by the demons in hell. They will deceive you. They will make you to postpone the time of your repentance. And then death will come suddenly and you will find yourself in hell. And these demons that will make you to miss heaven, they will still be the one who will curse you. They will still be the one to insult you. They will tell you you are a fool. And these people, when they saw the Lord, every one of them were begging, they were crying, shouting on top of their voice. They were telling the Lord, Lord, have mercy. I am ready to repent. We are ready to repent. But it was too late for them. The Lord did not pay attention to them, and the demons began to punish them. The demons punished them. The demons increased their punishment. And so I was also punished with these people. The demons chained every one of us down inside the fire, and they were flogging our backs again sometimes. We were crying and shouting, begging for mercy, begging the demons for mercy. The demons told us to keep quiet. We were shouting at us. We were telling us you had all the opportunity to repent, but you refused to repent. We will punish you in this place forever. Now, I told us yesterday that all what Jesus Christ went through for man, it signified many things. The price for our repentance, Jesus Christ, he paid for it. Now those people who are suffering in hell today, who are in hell today suffering, they are going through what Jesus Christ went through here on planet Earth. Jesus Christ suffered the greatest suffering. But if you can't, the suffering of Jesus Christ has nothing, then he will send you to hell for the demons to give you little taste of what he suffered. This is what all the souls in hell are passing through. They are having a little taste of what Jesus went through for them. also the chastisement for the repentance of man. And so when you fail to use that opportunity given to you by Jesus, when you die and go to hell, you will pay dearly for it. You will pay for it. The demons who were tormenting us, were some of us who were crying, shouting, begging the Lord for mercy, but Jesus turned his back. He was crying. Blood was coming out of his body. The Lord was weeping, and the demons, they were laughing, they were making jest of him. They were laughing, they were happy, jubilating. If the whole soul in this world is 100%, the devil and all his agents, they have succeeded in taking 97, remaining 3%. And the devil is still fighting every day. Him and all his angels, they are fighting every day to make sure they claim the remaining three. They want to have more souls. He wants to destroy the souls of man. But God is still working. God is still working to make sure that he draws man closer to himself. That is why God said in the book of Peter that my will, for everyone is not for any man to perish, but all should come to repentance. That all should come unto the repentance which Jesus Christ has offered out of his own will for man. But today the devil has made many people to count the suffering and the repentance Jesus Christ gave out of his own free will as nothing. And today, those people, they are in hell. They are crying and weeping, and they will remain there forever. And so we continue like that, and after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And they turned and they looked at me, and the Lord was happy. He was laughing. And he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me, then I felt peace. Then the Lord gave me a scripture, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The book of 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 9. Psalms chapter 9 verse 17. The book of Psalms chapter 9 verse 17. And Psalms chapter 9 verse 17 says that the wicked shall be torn into hell, and those, the nations that forget God. Who are these nations? Who are these people that forget God? These are the people who refuse to acknowledge the lordship of Jesus over their life, who refuse to repent, who refuse to take full advantage of the death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary for them. The Bible says that they shall be torn into hell. They will be torn into hell. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord took me to another place in hell. The section of punishment for those who use negative words. Section of punishment for those who use negative words. And in this place, demons, I saw demons, horrible demons, piercing their mouths in hell. And in this place, old women, there are very many in this place. You see some mothers, any little thing they pronounce curses on their children. They will tell their children, the same way you are doing to me, your children will do it back to you. And now they are dead. And they are in hell. And demons are piercing that mouth. That mouth that she used to pronounce that negative word. The demons, they are dealing with that mouth. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. They were crying, every one of them were shouting. When they saw the Lord, they were begging, calling him, begging him for mercy, that they will repent, they will not use negative force again, but it was too late for them. Leave those souls who are in hell today, if God should give them a second chance, to give them another opportunity for them to come back to planet Earth and amend their ways, they will do everything within their power to make sure that they don't return back to that place called hell.
cross in the name of Jesus.
Amen. So he was also punished for these people. Demons were piercing our mouth. The demons were telling us when we are asked to use negative words. And the Bible says that you should not use negative words, that all the words you use, all the negative words you use, that you will give account of it. That you use negative words, we will punish you in this place forever, and the demons will increase the punishment. And all the negative words we said, you are now demons, they brought everything, and they were telling us to continue saying it. Everything that is happening here in this world, everything you do here on earth, if you die, you go and continue over there. It is a continuation. If you are doing wickedness to yourself and to your fellow man, and you die in that wickedness, when you go to hell, you will continue from where you stop. It is a continuation. And everything that happened, God is taking record of it. Everything that happened, God is taking record of it. And it is out of that record that God will judge every man. It is out of that record God will judge every man. This judgment we are talking about, this is just a temporary judgment. The real judgment of God, the final judgment, God will be the one to do it. Then God will bring the whole world together before his throne. And the day of God's judgment, no man can escape it. The day that God will give his verdict, that God will judge man, that God will judge the devil and all his agents, it will be very horrible and fearful. And during that time that God will be given the judgment, Jesus Christ, he will no longer beg again. He will no longer plead for mercy. He will sit down at the right hand of his Father. He will sit down and watch God giving his judgment. Everything happening in this world, everything that man is doing, God knows about it. And so he will judge man from his records. Everybody born into this world, right from the very first day you are born into this world, God has a fight for your life. He has a fight for every man's life. In heaven, there's a way as where people's fight has stopped. Everything you are doing, God will be writing it inside that fire. And when you die, it is out of that fire he will judge you. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So we continue and crying and begging the Lord for mercy. Demons were laughing at us. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing and he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And they consoled me, then I felt peace. Then they gave me a scripture in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, verse 36. Matthew, chapter 12, verse 36. The Lord took me to another section, the section of punishment for those who refuse to forgive. Unforgiveness. Those who refuse to forgive. Today, unforgiveness is not in the house of God. That you see, faithfulness, keeping mindless with choir master, unforgiveness. And you call yourself Christians. Jesus said, if you fail to forgive men their trespasses, how will God forgive you? How will God forgive you? Many people today, they are in hell because of that sin of unforgiveness. They refuse to forgive. No matter how the persons offend you, no matter how painful it is, you must learn to forgive. Jesus suffered the greatest suffering upon all that man did to him, upon all the wickedness that was done to him, he still forgave. He still forgave. Even when he was on the cross, when said, Father, forgive man, for man does not know what he's doing. That was the words of Jesus. And if Jesus can pray for the forgiveness of man, after all the wickedness man has done to him, it is a sign to all that we must also learn to forgive no matter what. We must learn to forgive. But today, unforgiveness is in the house of God. There are so many things that is standing as an hindrance to the blessings of God upon his children. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Amen. And in this place, I saw every one of them. They all knelt down inside the fire. They were begging for forgiveness. But there was no forgiveness for them. The Lord did not pay attention to them. They are already doomed forever. And demons were laughing at them. The demons were telling them, when you are an ass and you refuse to forgive, and the Bible says you should forgive, but you refuse to forgive, we will punish you in this place forever and we will not have mercy on you. There is no forgiveness for you in this place. And demons increased their punishment. They were leaning down and begging inside the fire. Demons were tormenting them, flogging them. Flogging them. Because they refuse to repent. They refuse to forgive, sorry. They refuse to forgive. And as I was also punished with these people, the demon there, they made me to lay down inside the fire like others. Every one of us, we are begging demons, we are flogging us with gifts of tongues, we are crying and begging the Lord for mercy, but Jesus turned his back. The Lord was crying, he was weeping, blood was coming out of his body. And the demons, they were happy, they were laughing. They were telling us, when you are an ass, you refuse to forgive. And the Bible says you should forgive, but you refuse to forgive. Now we will punish you in this place forever. There is no forgiveness in this place. We will not forgive you. And every second the demons, they increase the punishment. Every second they increase the punishment. The demons there in hell, they are working tirelessly. They are not tired. And also in the kingdom of God, there are also angels working tirelessly. There are angels working tirelessly, working without end. But they are sure they are not doing anything. These angels, they are just standing folding their hands. Why other angels are working? Why they watch other angels working? Then I ask the Lord, why are these angels not working and the other angels are working? Then the Lord said, these angels that are not working, that these are the angels of some Christians who refuse to send materials up for their building. These people that they are only bench warmers in the church, they are not committed to any activity in the church, they are not committed to anything. They are not doing any work in the house of God. They just come, they warm the bench and they go home. I remember I told you that every man born into this world will have an angel God assigns to you. It is that angel that will give your report to God. If your works here on earth, the work you are doing in the house of God, it is that angel that will carry your work to heaven and use it to build your mansion. But if you are not working, you are just sitting down, you come as a bedroomer, the bedroomer you remain, and the bedroomer you remain as you go home. Nothing you are doing in the house of God, that is how that angel will be standing, watching all that fellow angels working. There are so many ways in which you can put this your angel to work. There are so many ways you can put this your angel to work. There are so many ways you can send up materials for your building, for your mansion. Jesus is the chief builder. He said, I go and prepare a place for you. When a man is building a house, the owner of that house, he will be the one to supply everything needed to build that house. Jesus is the chief builder. He is looking up to you for you to give him the materials he will use. And these materials, they are your day-to-day activities in the church. Your commitment to your activity in the church. All these, they are materials you are setting up for your building. As a worker, maybe you are a sweeper, you come to the church, the house of God is dirty. You don't wait for somebody to tell you, don't wait for your pastor to tell you. You pick up your broom and you sweep the church. There are materials you are setting up for your mansion. And the more you work tirelessly for God, the more your mansion is being built. continued crying and begging the Lord for mercy, begging him for forgiveness. But the Lord turned his back. Jesus was crying. Blood was coming out of his body and the demons were laughing. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing. And he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me. Then I felt peace. Then he gave me scripture, Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to 15. The book of Matthew chapter 6, 14 to 15. The Lord took me to a place in hell, the section of punishment for those who are walking up and down in the house of God, who are moving about in the house of God. They come to the house of God, they don't sit down one place. Every minute they are here, they are just moving around, doing nothing. They are not a worker. They just come, they move up and down to distract the service, to distract the attention of the people from God. There's a section in hell for them. And in this place, every one of them, they were all walking inside the fire of hell, with demons controlling them. The same way they were walking up and down in the house of God, that was how they continued over there then, and demons were controlling them. Demons were controlling them. Ushers are the only ones who are permitted to move in the house of God because they are to make sure that the attention of the people is focused on the word of God, focused on the preacher. To gain from God, to learn from God. But you as a listener, as you are focused on God, if the devil is trying to use sleep in order for him to prevent you from receiving the blessings of God, you must discipline yourself for you to stand up. Because this devil we are talking about is a very crafty man. He's a wise man. And it takes only the wisdom of God for you to overcome the wisdom of Satan. That is why the Greek, the Christians, they call the devil and his demons diabolos, meaning intelligent beings. They know about things that man did not know. Satan was once an angel of God. He knows little of God's knowledge. Why? Because he was once an angel of God. And the knowledge of angels, they are higher than the knowledge of man. So you need a higher knowledge for you to overcome the knowledge of Satan. This Satan we are talking about is a very crafty man. He has many ways for him to snatch the blessings of the children of God. And one way he uses sleep. Maybe you are praying, you are asking God for something. And maybe service like this, the answer to your prayer has come. The devil will come, he will blow you to sleep. He will sleep and that blessing will pass you. You will not get it. You see the craftiness of the devil in the house of God. So you, as a believer, the more you listen to God, the more you are ready to give for God. If you are trying to sleep, discipline yourself and stand up. Stand up. May the Lord give you such understanding in the name of Jesus. They were all moving inside the fire of hell. Children were there. Adults were also there. Demons were controlling them in the head. They were moving inside the fire of hell. Worms were feeding on them. And when they saw the Lord, they were crying, every one of them shouting on top of their voice. They were begging the Lord, Lord have mercy, I will not move any higher again in the church. I will not move any higher again in the house. Forgive me, bring me out of this place. So we were begging the Lord to bring them out of that place for 1 second, 5 minutes, 3 minutes, 10 minutes. But nothing like that was given to them. They remained there. And demons were laughing, demons punished them, demons told them, keep quiet. When you are an ass, you are moving up and down in the church. And the Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, I told you, priests, the demons there, they know the Bible. From Revelation, from Genesis to Revelation, they know everything in the Bible. So they quote the scripture. These demons, they respect, they had for God when they were in heaven. That respect is still with them. That is why when Jesus opened his mouth and he rebuked them, they always bow. respect they had for him
when they were in heaven.
So that respect is still with them. The demons, the devil and his angels, they are still afraid of God. The man,
he said, no, you God, I'm not afraid of you. Who are you?
Man is struggling with God, fighting against God.
And God said, my spirit will not always strive with man.
God will not always strive with man. God is telling man, do it this way. Man is telling God, no,
I'm the owner of my life. It is how I want to live my life. It is how I want to do it. That is how we do it. And God is saying he's not ready to strive with man today. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
So I was also punished with these people. We were all moving inside the fire of death. Demons were controlling us. We were crying, shouting, begging the Lord for mercy. The Lord turned his back. Jesus was crying. Blood was coming out of his body. And the demons, they were laughing. The demons, they were jubilating. They were happy. They were telling us, when you are on earth, we are moving anyhow in the house of God. Now we will punish you in this place forever. We will torment you. And demons, they increase the punishment. We are all moving inside the fire of hell. Every one of us, both great and small, old and young, they were all there, moving inside the fire of hell. Why? Because they did not keep their food when they were in the house of God. So we continue like that, and after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing and lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me. Then I felt peace. Then he gave me scripture, Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 1. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 1. And Ecclesiastes 5 verse 1 says, keep your foot when thou goest into the house of the Lord. Sit down one place when you are in the house of God. Say, be ready to hear rather than to give God the sacrifice of food. Many of you parents, you have children. Instead of you to take care of the children, maybe the children teacher is not around. Take care of your children. If you allow your children to move anywhere in the house of God to distract the service, if that child dies, God will send that child to hell. And as that child is in hell, when you die, God will require the blood of the child from your hand. Every child God gives to you, he expects you to return that child back to heaven where that child came from. The only way your hand is free from the blood of that child as a parent is the day that that child gets married. Because the Bible says a man will leave his father and his mother, he will join himself to his wife, and both of them will become one. Right from that day your child gets married, you are free from his blood. Your hands are free from his blood. But in as far as the child is still growing up, you are in the position and in the duty to correct the child. Because if anything happens to that child and that child is in hell, God will require the blood of the child from your hand. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. I'm rounding up. I have only three sessions to share with you before I hand off. The Lord took me to a place in hell, the section of punishment for those who love their work more than God. This thing is found with Christians. Many of you Christians, the time you are supposed to be in the church, you are using it for your business. Because of your business, because of your work, you come to church late. And when your pastor questions you, sister, why did you come to church late? Now, pastor, you know now my work. You are using your work to give excuse, but on that day your work is not an excuse before God. When you die, he will send you to hell. People, there are very many in this place. They love their work more than God. Their business, they are always concerned about their business. They are not concerned about God. They are not concerned about the things of God. All they are concerned about is just their business. How to make money, quick money. That is what they are concerned about. If you know you are like this, you better change or else you will die and you will go and meet your fellow people who love their work more than God in hell. You will go there and join them. The time for your
Bible study is 5 o'clock. Make sure that 15 minutes to that 5 o'clock you have closed from your work and come to church.
The time for your service is 5 o'clock. You enter into the church 6 o'clock, 6:30, because of your work, because of your business. May the Lord deliver his church in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Muslims, the reason why I have little respect for Muslims, once it is time for that their prayer, all their business, they will leave everything. They will run and go and pray. But Christian, 5 o'clock, you know 5 o'clock is the Bible study. You are staying in your small selling. But Muslims who do not have the true God, they respect and honor that their God, call Allah. Once it is time for their prayer, if you come to their shop to buy something, they will not sell for you. But if it is Christian, that is the time they will sell very well. You see how Christians, they are disgracing their God. They don't have value for their God. But Muslims, they value the words of their God. What are Christians? You see Christians today, they treat their God anyhow. May the Lord deliver his church in the name of Jesus. Demons were tormenting them. Demons punished them with all kinds of weapons. And demons were calling them fools. They loved their work, Father God. And they were crying and begging the Lord for mercy, but the Lord turned his back. And I was also punished with them. We were crying and begging the Lord for mercy. The demons were laughing. They were telling us to keep quiet. Now when we are out, we loved our work more than God. We love our work more than the Creator. Jesus Christ said, whatsoever thing that will cause you to sin, take it away. Is it your eye? Pluck it out. Anything that will drag you to hell, do away with that thing. Is it your work? If you know your work is depriving you of your mind for God, resign from that work before it is too late for you. Because the devil is using that work to deprive you of God's blessings. Resign from that work because of God, and God will give you a better job.
May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So we continue like that, and after some time I beg the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place, and he consoled me, then I felt peace. Then the Lord took me to a place in hell again, the section of punishment for those who go to church without Bible. Those who come to church without Bible. How can a farmer go to farm without a glass or hoe? It is not possible. The Christians today, they come to church without Bible. Muslims, when they are going to mosques, their Quran is with them. They have their rosary is with them. The Christians, you see them, they come into the house of God, they call any passage in the Bible. Other people are hoping you are there looking at them. You are there looking at them. I want to tell you something which the Antichrist, the plan of the Antichrist concerning Bible. According to the revelation the Lord gave to me on the 3rd of December 2013, I saw that the plan of the Antichrist concerning Bible is to wipe out Bible from this whole world. And the Antichrist, he has already devised different means for him to take out the Bible from this whole world. And today, that is why you have Bible in phones. The Antichrist was the one who invented it, so that the children of God, so that people will no longer have time again to carry their Bible to the church. They will not have time for Bible. And after the rapture, the Antichrist will give an order, because at that time he will be the world ruler. He will rule this world for 7 years. He will give an order to all his soldiers that any more fan carrying this book, they should be killed. They should be arrested. And he will order that this Bible should be wiped out from this whole world. And the Bible says, in the latter days, there will be famine of the word of God. This was what the Bible was prophesying about, that during the reign of the Antichrist, men, they will look for the word of God, but they will not receive.
after the rapture, so many people who are running and asking are looking for God's word
to give them comfort and boldness
for them to be able to stand in the air. And during that time, many people who went to meet their brothers and please, brother, encourage me with the word of God. The brother will say, the word of God that I will have is not enough for me.
And many people, they remember, yes, I have Bible in my phone. Let me open my Bible inside my phone so that I will read. They will open it. The Bible is not there. Everything is gone.
You see the strategy of the devil. You see the plan of Satan concerning the word of God. So now that Bible is still available, you should have your own personal copy of your Bible. Have your own personal copy.
May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. People who go to church without Bible, and in this place, demons command them with all kinds of weaponry, like crying, shouting on top of their voice, begging the Lord for mercy that they will go to church with Bible, but it was too late for them.
It was too late for them.
Now that the word of God is still available, have your own copy.
Because a time is coming that you will fall into temptation and you need the word of God for you to stand.
You don't have the Bible. Temptation of God. You don't know the word of God. You don't know how to put the word of God. You just fall into it.
But when you know the word of God, you have. When temptation comes, you open God's word, you quote out God's word, you will discover that you will overcome that temptation.
May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So I was also punished with these people. Demons were tormenting us with all kinds of weapons. They were telling us, you are a fool. The word of God was available for you, but you refused to make use of it. You refuse to have the word of God with you. You refuse to go to church with Bible. We will punish you in this place forever. And the demons here will increase the punishment. So we continue now crying and begging the Lord for mercy, but the Lord done his back. And demons were laughing. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing and he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me, then I felt peace. Lastly, the Lord took me to a section in hell, the section of punishment for those who believe in traditional things. Those who believe in traditional things. When the Lord took me to this place, and I asked the Lord, God, is any of my relation in this place? Then the Lord said, yes. So, we are dead. And then the Lord, they called out a man and a woman. And he told me, these are your relations. I was looking at them, I could not recognize them. And then the Lord stretched forth his hand and his light shined on them. And when I saw them, I recognized them. Behold, it was my great-grandmother and my grandfather, the father of my mother. And my great-grandmother, both of them, they are in this place, in this section of punishment for those who believe in traditional things. My grandfather, I did not know him. I didn't see him before he died, but I only saw his photograph. And with his photograph, I was able to recognize him in heaven. That this man is my grandfather. My great-grandmother was a baby when she died. When my great-grandmother died, according to the story my dad told us, every one of them, they were happy thinking that great-grandma has gone to heaven. But they never knew she's in hell. They never knew she's in hell. And they were tormented in the midst of the fire of hell. They were crying when they saw the Lord. They were gnashing their teeth. Every one of them there. In peace, begging the Lord for mercy. And my great-grandmother, which God took her to hellfire. My great-grandmother, she she was a woman who served God all the days of her life. To the point that even she was sick, no strength again, she was very old. But once it is time for church service, because her house is beside the church, we look for somebody to hold her by the hand and cross the road so that she will be able to church. She was committed to the work of God, always wanting to walk and do the work of God. And at the point of her death, she made an error. Instead of her advising her children, my children, follow the word of God, she advised them to follow the ways of idols. And she told her children, my children, when I die, the family, my family, they will come and request for wisdom. You people should give that wisdom to them. And because of that, Jesus sent her to them. All her works, all her righteousness, Jesus forgot about everything. He judged her with that error. And today, she's dead. And the Lord showed me her mansion. This woman she lived in Hebron. The Lord showed me her mansion, her glorious throne, her white robe, and her crown was on the white robe. The white robe and her crown of glory was on her seat. And the Lord said, another person will take that position. The rightful owner of that position, the rightful owner of that place is in hell. Another person will go and eat the fruit of her labor. You see how the devil deprived my great-grandmother of reaping the fruits of her labor. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. What a beautiful thing for you to live all your life. At the end, all what you live on for, you see, lost it. You see, lost it. The Lord also showed me my grandfather and my auntie in heaven. The father of my father is in heaven, and my auntie is my mom's younger sister. Both of them, they are in heaven, but they don't have a word. They are in a place called Town Hall in heaven because there's a big hall in heaven made by God. And that place is meant for those people who did not have time to work for God, who did not have time to do the work of God, who gave their life to Jesus at their dying bed. That is the place meant for them. My auntie and my grandfather, they gave their life to Jesus on their dying bed. So both of them, they are dead. And my great, and my grandfather, the father of my father, he was an idol worshiper. He served idols all the days of his life, and before he died, my father ministered Christ to him, and he accepted Jesus. On Sunday evening, Monday morning, he died. He narrowly escaped hell. But my great-grandmother, who was in God, she went to hell. No wonder Jesus Christ said, the first will become the last, and the last will become the first. My auntie, the same thing. Someday like this, my mom led her to Christ. On Monday, she died, and she went into that place. That was a place meant for them. What a beautiful thing. You see how reversed was the case. That is why every word spoken by God, they must surely come to pass. When God told Ezekiel, if a righteous man live righteousness and do evil, I will judge him without evil. And I was punished with them. I was punished with my grandfather, my great-grandmother, in the midst of the fire of hell. We were crying and shouting, begging the Lord for mercy, but the Lord on his back. The Lord was crying. Blood was coming out of his body, and the demons were laughing. The demons were laughing. They were telling us, you say you are a Christian, you say, you serve God. When you are an heir, you believe in the tradition of your fathers. You believe in the tradition of your lands. Now we will punish you in this place forever. Many of you still believe in wasteful killing. You believe in wasteful. You say, oh, me, I did not buy, but you contributed your money. If you contribute to the buying of that wasteful, you are also involved in that sin. You are not exempted. And with
God will judge. God will judge you squarely. Anything that consigns ungodly traditions, withdraw from it. The tradition of your land, run away from them. Tradition of your land, that they tell you, if a woman lost her husband, they will wash the dead corpse of that man and give the woman to drink. Tradition of your fathers. If you are involved in it, you will die and you will go to hell. Now you that are Christians, in your family, in your land where you came from, you need to make your stand known to them that I am a Christian. This is what my Bible tells me and this is what I must follow. When you make your stand known to them, when they want to do all these things, they will not involve you. This was what my mother did. She made her stand known to her family because her family, they believe so much in idols. She made her stand known to them, I am a Christian, I cannot be a partaker of it. So when they want to do all this, their idols, they don't call her. They don't call her. Why? Because she has made her stand known to them. But when you have not made your stand known to them, they want to deal with all you. They will put pressure on you that you must contribute. This is how the devil lure people into sin, into bondage. And then he will send them to hell. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So we're continuing in this place. And after some time, I begged the Lord to take me out of this place. And the Lord turned and he looked at me. He was smiling. He was laughing. And he lifted up his hand and brought me out of this place. And he consoled me. Then I felt peace. What a painful thing. My great grandmother to this is in hell. My grandfather is in hell. My two grandfathers, they were idol worshippers. The father of my father, he was an idol worshipper. The father of my mother, also an idol worshipper. They served idols. My mother's father served idols all the days of his life, even to the point of his death. He was still serving idols. And today, the man is in hell. But my other grandfather, the father of my father, God gave him a narrow escape. Narrow escape from hell. He narrowly escaped hell. My uncle, the younger brother of my father, he went to this Yoruba land. And the man that took him there went and took him to a spiritualist. And the spiritualist, he told him that my grandfather, the devil has already created a vacant place in hell for him. He said, but God used my father to deliver him from that vacant place. He said that until today, that vacant place, that vacant position created for my grandfather, that place is still vacant, and that one member of our family must be that vacancy. To see how the devil is working every day to take souls of life. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. Stand up on your feet, we want to talk to God. We want to talk to God. The will of God for us is not for any of us to perish, but that all of us will come unto repentance. You are going to tell the Lord, oh Lord, my God, help me not to fall into errors after my labor for you. Open your mouth and begin to talk to the Lord. Tell the Lord to help you not to fall into sin, not to fall into errors after you have labored all your life for him. At the point of your death, you fall into sin. You fall into error. Father, oh God, help me not to labor and fall into errors, oh God. Help me not to fall into errors after my labor for you, oh God. After I have worked for you, Baba, help me not to fall into errors. Help me not to fall into errors so that I will not lose my reward. So that I will not lose my reward. Lord, help me. 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 Father, help me, O God. Help me not to fall into errors after I have labored for you. Help me not to fall into errors after I have worked for you.
revelation my dad was sharing with you. That pastor, that was the last minute mistake of his life. You see how the devil brought that temptation for him to this heaven. My great-grandmother, she also made that last minute mistake of her life. At the point of her death, Satan brought that idea. And she accepted the idea, she passed that idea out to her children. And because of that, Jesus sent her to them. Pastor, you are going to tell the Lord, oh Lord, deliver my soul from the last minute mistake. Open your mouth and begin to talk to the Lord. The last minute mistake. The day you are going to leave this world. The day that you will preach your last breath. As a Christian, as a child of God in this world. Tell the Lord to deliver you from every last minute error. That we thank you. That after breathing your last breath, your heart, you will find yourself in hell. Because of that little error. Because of that singular error. Open your mouth and tell the Lord. Oh Lord, deliver me. Oh Lord, deliver my soul. From the last minute mistake. From the last minute error. Baba, deliver my soul. Save me, oh God. From the last minute mistake of my life. That last minute mistake. That will damn my soul in hell.